This is the Literary License Podcast, European Horror Edition, with your hosts, Will Millar, Vicky Ray, and Keith Chorgo, discussing European horror that gives reason to be afraid. So very afraid. Coming at you from Europe and the USA.
Welcome to Literary License Podcast, and today we'll be discussing the French film Frontiers. And with us today we have Vicky Ray. Hello, Vicky.
Hi, everybody.
And we have our normal co-host for European Horror, Will Millar. Hello, Will.
Hey, gang, how's it going?
It's going. Hey, Will.
And before we get started, let's find out what we've been up to since last time we spoke. So, Will, what have you been up to since last time we spoke to you?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know. It's been a month, and it feels like, as usual, it feels like it's been like 2 or 3 days. I got tapped to do a charity event out in Boston this April. I'm going to be talking about it towards the end too, but I've been kind of wrapping my head around that, and also just working on a lot of just long-term fiction projects right now. So
you're always doing something. You're always up to something.
Yeah, well, I was doing the Medium articles, and then my computer crashed, so I've just kind of been handwriting a lot of stuff for the last couple of weeks while I'm shopping for a new laptop. So I guess that's kind of been the arc of this month. But yeah, you're right. I'm just a hyperactive human, I guess. So.
Good. Yeah. What about yourself, Vicky? What have you been up to?
Not a whole lot. Just getting ready for the silly season. We're getting ready to go to Tulsa for 4 or 5 days because Asher has been invited back to the Race of Champions.
And Tulsa spell backwards is a slut.
Yeah, yep, basically. Slut A. I don't care. I don't live there.
A slut, okay.
Slut A, okay. Make the okay sign for all of you white supremacists out there. But anyway, I finished watching American Horror Story, and I really liked the end. I won't say anything. I didn't know if you watched it yet.
Yeah, I watched it.
I really loved the finale. I really liked it. I almost was crying. It's like, I missed the 80s. I was sitting there thinking maybe my Reeboks and my LA Gear sneakers will come back if enough people watch American Horror Story, you know, make Reeboks cool again, my high tops. Mm-hmm. And I watched Nightmare Cinema. I haven't watched it all yet, but it's hysterical. It's like really trashy B kind of stuff, you know, making fun of horror movies, I guess. And I started watching The Watchmen on Amazon.
Oh, yeah. Is any good?
I'm kind of enjoying it. I'm waiting for the next episode to come out. So far, so good. It's not your typical, superhero series. But I'm really liking it. The cops all have to wear masks and stuff. They're not supposed to be recognized. If you're a police officer, you always have to wear a mask. No one needs to know where you are for whatever reason. But no, it's pretty enticing. So I'm kind of liking it. I suggest it to anybody out there like superhero stuff. Other than that, just chilling. What about you?
I finished Atypical on Netflix, which is a fantastic series. Loved it. Loved every moment of it. And a co-worker turned me on to The Klumsky Method, starring Alan Arkin and Michael Douglas. Brilliant. I suggest anyone that's of our age to watch it because
what it's is fantastic. It again?
The Kominsky Method.
I flashed by it and I didn't stop.
I highly recommend it. I started watching it on a Monday and I was finished by Tuesday. Now I was 2 seasons of it. They're short episodes.
Are they like eight episodes?
10 episodes per season, and each episode is about 22-23 minutes long.
Oh, really? I cruised that really quick.
And it's got, you know, and you get Elliot Gould pops up in it.
Really?
And Jane Seymour's in it, and Anne Margaret pops up in it, and Patti LaBelle, and Elliot Gould.
Oh, cool.
It's brilliant. It's probably one of the best written shows I've watched in a long time.
Well, look who's in it.
I know. And I also watched, I'm almost finished with Swamp Thing, which is a...
I just haven't started that yet. I keep getting into something else.
It is gory, but brilliant. It's probably the only comic book thing I've watched that I've actually been enjoyed. So I'm quite enjoying that. And The Purge. Still watch going through The Purge. So I'm really enjoying that. That's quite interesting. But other than that, I watched Cannibal Holocaust today because I wanted some light Saturday.
And I have to say
it's a really good film. I have to sit there and say, because I watched, I've never seen the cleaned up high definition version of it. But I have to sit there and say the way that it's structured and the way it's done.
You know what? Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm just jumping in and you're absolutely right. And I'm glad you're bringing it up because we're going to talk about this movie Frontiers today, which I think has a lot. It shares a lot of the DNA with Cannibal Holocaust, but it technically is. It's a surprisingly good film. It's
Cannibal Holocaust. Well. I have to watch it now. Dang it!
You did watch it. That was one of your choices.
That was Cannibal Ferox.
Oh, okay.
So you watched Cannibal Ferox with the turtle. They tipped upside down and started boiling the turtle alive.
No, they cut the turtle.
Okay, well, that was the anti-PETA movie. I mean, they had so many acts of violence against animals on that movie. I was really disturbed, I have to admit. I was disturbed.
It's pretty sad that we're more offended by animal violence than we are the people and people violence.
People deserve it, though.
This is the world that we live in. But yeah, carry on from what we'll say. It's a really well done film. It's on Amazon Prime, so
okay.
But I just thought, okay, you know, I haven't seen this in ages. I've seen the Eli Roth nod to it called Green Inferno.
And actually
watching, I understand where Green Inferno comes from now.
The Green Inferno just was not enough blood and gore for me.
But I have to say the structure of it is really, really good. Now, I think that some of the comments that you hear about is that, oh, the acting. But, you know, what I think it is that everyone in this film is Italian. So I got a feeling that they probably were dubbed. Because Italian films, what they do is they dub people afterwards.
Yeah.
Well, so I got a feeling it was that.
Yeah, the structure of storytelling in Italian is just different, too. Like, it's not expected to be as linear, and so you have a lot of like swinging for the fences when they do these parts. It's just I don't know, movies were a different sort of thing to them than it is to what it is
right now,
you know.
And I was quite impressed that one of the art directors on it was Roberto Bava, so I was quite impressed. I was like, ooh, what's, oh my God, it's Roberto Bava. What's he doing in it? So, but yeah, it's I highly recommend it actually for 1982. I think it came out because they showed, there's a scene where they're in like New York City and they show the billboards and it's got Dracula with what's his name, Frank Langella, whatever his name
Langella.
and Evita. There's Evita's. I was like, okay, this is like 1979 to 1981 sort of thing. So,
Evita. But yeah. Well, the movie came out like in the early 90s, didn't it? For Evita.
It was at theater. Yeah, 76 is when the thingy came out. Then I think it hits like a couple years later. And then it turned into a stage musical from a concept album.
So
that's very good. And I started watching an older show, which is on Amazon Prime, The United States of Tara, about a woman with split personalities. Brilliant. So it's got a really good cast. So I'm really enjoying that as well. But that's about it. So that brings us to Frontiers. It's a 2007 horror film written and directed by Xavier Gans. Now, Xavier Gans, you might know some of his other work. Vicky mentioned it in one of our Shudder episodes, Cold Skin.
Yeah.
That was one of his films that he's done.
That was a good movie.
He did some stuff for the ABCs of Death. It's a short film. He did The Letter X. He did The Divide, which is actually on Netflix at the moment. Hitman. But I don't think he's ever been able to hit past Frontiers. I think once he started working in the American market, I think that's where most of the directors, that, you know, I think they kind of lose their voice a little bit, unfortunately. Yeah. The film had its premiere in France at the Adgate Film Festival in 2007. The film was given a limited release with an NC-17 rating in the United States on May 9th, 2008 as part of the After Dark Horror Fest. This film has been banned and unbanned and banned in quite a few countries. It seems to go back and forth depending on what political party is in that country at the moment and whether you got mad mothers and drunk drivers, you know, raising their ugly head about securing their children or whatever. So this film tends to have it going back and forth. What makes this interesting is basically, the film's basically about Trump wins the election and all Antifa goes out onto the streets and massacres against everyone. And so while this is happening, a bunch of young criminals go out and rob a bank, and then they find themselves caught in a family of socialists. But no, I'm only kidding.
No, Nazis. You might as well be, they might as well be. But I wasn't expecting in the Nazi thing. But I was just like, God, man, I mean, some of these guys are still fighting the war, I guess. They're still alive. But this guy was ultra evil.
But in all honesty, the film does follow a group of young criminals from Paris who lodge at a countryside inn run by neo-Nazis in the aftermath of riots spurred by a controversial presidential election. So what we're going to do is cut to a commercial break and to the trailer Frontiers. We'll be back after a word from our sponsor.
We are one planet. We share one extraordinary home. We are millions of wonders, but we are all one world. If we only get one chance to save our planet, to protect it for the next generation, then we have to take it. This is our chance. This is our fight. For our planet, for our home, for all of us. Join WWF today.
Scary movie.
I have a bunch of favorite movies. I watch them all on Shudder.com for only $4.99 a month.
That's a scary low price.
But if I had to pick a favorite, it'd probably be Scream.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the only streaming service that lets me watch hundreds of horror movies on demand.
I'll be right back.
Hello? Hello? Hello, are you gonna subscribe? Hello?
Go to Shudder.com to subscribe, if you dare.
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast, and we're discussing Frontiers, a 2007 horror film from France. So, Will, what are your thoughts on Frontiers?
Well, okay, so Xavier Gans makes this film in 2007. You're actually seeing the new wave of French horror. If you're seeing it as an actual wave, it's now hitting its peak because you've had, High Tension, and you've had beyond that, Interiors, which we did the other one. This was sort of a nod to both of those movies. You see with the pregnant Yasmin as the main protagonist. But also, there's a couple of really interesting things about Frontiers if you look at it as an experiment of like a time capsule. For one, it's one of the only movies that I know of that received an NC-17 for violence only. There's little to no sex in the movie, other than there's a scene where the two,
crazy women, those two crazy bitches.
Yeah, they make out for a bit, and then you see like a flash of Yasmin's side boob after she's been kidnapped a bunch of times. But that's really it. There's very little sex. So this is an NC-17 for violence, which, again, it's not something you run into a lot. It's usually there's a more of a sex component that gets right. at that.
That was pretty violent.
it's incredibly violent, but it's also, I don't know, how much more violent is it than, I've seen episodes of The Walking Dead that are probably about as violent as this.
Oh, movie. Yeah, easy. Every Sunday. they've gotten so bloody. They've gotten worse with age. I mean, they're more bloody now than they ever were in season one and two.
Right. So, again, if you think about this as a time capsule, which is what I was originally, like, it's very interesting to see how far we've fucking come, like, in just how deranged we are just as a general public. I don't know what to make of that, but there's one thing. The other thing is, so the whole premise of the movie is this Nazi guy gets elected, right? And then there's rioting in the streets, okay? Well, what happens? 12 years later, Macron is elected. He's about as far from a Nazi as you can get. For all of his, craziness, what do we still have? Not rioting in the streets. So this is very interesting because I think it kind of demonstrates the idea that the governments that we have in place are acting as a fulfillment layer for the, you can call it the billionaire class or the royals or whatever you want.
Well, they have been rioting because they're sick of the taxes in France.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
I'm telling you, that's what I'm saying. This is the whole point. We're seeing evidence of colony collapse because the governments aren't fucking doing the jobs that we keep thinking that they're going to do.
No, they're not governing. That's what they're doing.
Yeah, if we vote this way or that way, we'll get the right guy in, and the right guy just keeps being a fucking caricature of the guy who was just before him.
We're never going to get that utopia. Never going to happen as long as there's greed.
Yeah, so the riots that the supposed Nazi guy would have brought in have been brought in from, the corporate centrist, blue check friendly guy who's in place anyway. You see, so that's really just interesting to think about. Anyway, I had those two things. Aside from that, this is probably it's an example of a horror film that's part of a movement that was like it was as good as it was going to get, and then everybody kind of started doing their own things elsewhere. So like, what I mean by that is with the new French horror movement, you have like guys like Alexandre Aja, who did High Tension, and then he comes to America and does a bunch of really very well executed American horror movies. Yeah. This guy, Xavier Gans, I think he's doing video games now, isn't he?
Yeah, I believe he's started in that field. I mean, but he did do a really good one called Cold Skin, which I'll give him credit for that one.
I haven't seen that. I'll have to check it out.
It's a good movie.
But like, yeah,
I think it's on Shudder.
So what happened was the movement kind of launched a bunch of people, and then there was kind of a vacuum from like 2007 on in that genre. And then this is another sort of example of at some point, like the new French horror kind of got blended with American torture porn. And this is sort of kind of the mutant outgrowth of both of those movements, because you have like a lot of the characters. I'm thinking of Tom. Tom is like he's like a voodoo doll of like, toxic masculinity plus virtue signaling plus all of these other
toxic
very
masculinity. I don't know. Sorry, but every time I hear that term, I just start laughing.
Well, if you think like there's a lot of those kind of base level messages going on with this movie, like Nazi bad.
I agree. Yeah.
So it's I don't know. Anyway.
Pregnant for one. For our listeners, she and this Yasmin, our protagonist or our main character, our final girl, whatever you want to call her.
Yes.
I think it's
a direct nod to Inside.
And on top of that, they are they're not Muslim, but they are Muslim Arab youths. All these kids.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that gives you a little more of her cultural experience, being pregnant, unwed. So,
I mean, I guess I found with the film, I found that they're not very likable, any of them.
No. I'm almost wanting to see them all get killed.
This whole movie, they're all villains. Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought that was quite, even at Gasman, it's like, I didn't really root for her. As far as this movie, this works in this movie, but it found quite weird to have someone that you're not actually rooting for at all.
I was kind of rooting for her because it was such a horrible situation. I mean, here they these people end up in this hotel, and she finally gets away, but she doesn't,
But you also got to remember what they've done.
Yeah, they robbed. They're murderers.
They killed people. They robbed. Yeah. And then they're basically escaping. They find themselves. So it's not, which is, doesn't fall into your American construct of a horror movie, you have like a bunch of college kids. Yes, they might be taking a little bit of drugs, and yes, they might be a bit more cocky than normal. But then when they find themselves in this kind of situation, you do kind of. We always have like the good girl that you can like root for, who always like the final girl. Don't really have that. Yasmin's kind of, she's a kind of an odd, complex character, I find, because the thing is like, once she leaves her brother there, but then at the end of the day, I mean, she's running off because, to be with this guy who doesn't even want to be with her anymore. And I know she holds her brother's hand, but then at the end of the day, her brother dies, and she's so upset. But at the same time, she can't wait to get out of there because she doesn't want to give herself up or anything like that. Even though she didn't have, but another thing, we're not quite sure how active is she in the bank robbery because the way the film was constructed, we start out with the riots, which looks like actual news footage and stuff like this, which is quite interesting because now we're like, okay, there's political unrest going on here. Then we think that there might be part of it, but then we realize that they're not part of it. They're using this as a vice to rob a bank.
Right.
So that way they can't get caught in there. And then you see the violence that explodes that they do. But then you kind of got her off to the side. So you're not quite sure, does she just know the people in the bank robbery, or was she part of the bank robbery?
She looked like she was pretty entangled to me.
Well, I'm saying it doesn't really make clear if she was, because we know that the men were.
Right.
But we're not quite sure if she's guilty by association or she guilty by the act of being a bank robber. And the relationships are very, very muddied as far as, you're looking at these people who are supposedly friends, but they're not really good friends. They're put together because of circumstance more than they might be like a family. You know how like you're forced with your family and there's nothing you can do about it? And they felt kind of like that. They're like this family unit that have been forced together, and there's no way that they can divide themselves up from each other. And I thought that made the film very, very interesting. And then they go into the neo-Nazi situation. And again, we have this family that are kind of forced together and they can't break away from this. And even the women that get indoctrinated into this family to be the spouses to carry on the family name and carry on.
The one girl there that was the sweater, she wasn't the bombshell kind of, other villainous. The other one was, who was like really slutty, but she always looked disgusted throughout the whole film, didn't she? She was just like disgusted with everybody.
are you talking about the one who's pregnant or the other girl?
No, the villains, the two women that seduce.
Yeah. Well, to see that's the power.
You're talking about Claudia. Yeah. Claudia had an attitude the whole time. Whereas, Gertrude or have their names like rolled up.
Gilbert. Their name Gilbert.
Who always looks slightly crazy.
Yeah. But I think, but see what you get there, which they do bring this out. The reason why that is because there's a power struggle going on within the family.
Oh yeah.
And Gilbert, I think Gilbert is not married to anyone. She's the daughter. So she's been given up for any kind of role as to take over the family name when the Nazi daddy dies. So then what you got is Claudia, who's married to Getz. She's married to Getz. And so therefore there's this power struggle going between Getz and the other brother. And so that's, so basically the reason why she's disgusted, because she does say this at the end there, where she goes, you know, you're giving me all these shitty jobs to do. And she goes, and I'm a get sort of thing. And they're going, well, this is our daughter, you know, sort of thing. So the daughter.
Well, how many times did she probably get pregnant to produce the perfect heir, you know?
Well, you're talking about the other girl. She's the one that was kind of like with the slightly mental, I guess we'll say mentally slow, or the one with learning difficulties, I'm guessing. You know, the leather face version of the French leather face version of this guy, you know, who's been like kind of slow. And she keeps, you know, she's scary on the family name. She keeps, you know, having mutated children, which we never really see. Yeah. So I think that what you have there is, I mean, and I guess it's quite interesting because you do have two groups. Well, basically, you got the power struggle going on in the streets of Paris. You had the power struggle going on with the criminals, and then you got the power struggle going on with the family. And it's almost like leaving one power struggle behind yourself in the middle of another power struggle.
Yeah, there's a lot going on with this whole movie. I mean, it's one that
it's
this
busy.
Movie seems to be a pastiche of like a whole bunch of other movies, because you know you've got. A nod to the character from Inside, and then their whole bit as being like the runaway bank robbers has a very Man Bites Dog vibe to it. So
yeah.
So I'm seeing a lot of other, and then of course like there's a lot of we haven't even really talked about this movie. Kind of has two speeds to it, or actually three if you think about it, because the first act could be described as them just all getting to the house and then everyone getting kind of chopped up
right.
Very fast in that sort of second act, and then the third act being starting with Yasmin getting her head shaved, and then the whole movie has an almost very it has a mythical sort of feel to it. If you guys have ever heard the story of like the you know, Persephone being dragged into the underworld in Hades, there's a lot of imagery, like the way that she's shed, her clothes are all shed, her head is shaved, she puts on the white bridal gown, and then things get even stranger at the dinner. There's like a marriage, sort of. There's a lot of almost, just a lot of like black magic that's kind of just right below the surface level you're seeing in these themes that they're bringing out. And they're
almost a stressful movie. It gave me anxiety.
I think one of the best technical things that they do in this movie is they bring out all of this violence, and it happens very fast, right? And then it stops, and then there's this almost dreamlike sequence for almost about five straight minutes where she's getting her head cut or her hair cut with a pair of very sharp scissors. Again, another nod to Inside, and the scissors keep kind of like almost nicking her ear and almost nicking her neck, and you've just watched a bunch of people get chopped into hamburgers.
God, I forgot about that movie Inside. That was another dilly. Oof.
Oh yeah for sure.
That one was disturbing as fuck too.
Well, this movie was kind of like the Hold My Beer to that movie. Like all of these people were operating in the same circles at the same time in France.
Yeah.
So I think that this movie kind of, it was sort of a nod to that and an attempt to one-up the gore, because they couldn't really make it as scary as Inside was. Inside is definitely the scarier of these two movies. Well, this one has just crazy technical gore effects and just a lot of really intense character arcs too. This reminds me of, if you guys read Jack Ketchum at all, this reminds me of a lot of Jack Ketchum novels. It's just like
Offspring and The Woman.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Think of that. Like that's what this movie is kind of like a realization of that sort of super noir that you know, it's just that substrate of horror, I guess. Anyway, there's, like I said, there's just a lot going on with this movie. Even though it looks like sometimes just almost like a European Eli Roth knockoff, it's not quite that. There's just other things at play.
I didn't think it struck me as an Eli Roth knockoff.
Well, really. I did get, I think it's because this, while we had extreme European horror going on, which this is like,
yeah,
you know, one of those. At that time, we were having torture porn going on in America, where you had Hostel and Saul, and that was kind of
films. Oh God, let's talk
at the same right. So America was doing torture porn, and Franchi and the French were doing extreme horror. And so basically, what's happening is people who don't like horror were kind of like thinking that they're all part of the same wave, but they weren't, you know, sort of thing.
Yeah. And I'm not bashing torture porn or Eli Roth. I think that there's actually some decent movies in that genre. I think that the collector movies are fucking amazing. And they're squarely in that torture porn camp, but they're just well done. And I think that this movie is even a nod to Eli Roth, because that character Tom looks like somebody fucking stuck an Eminem wig on Eli Roth himself. Like, Tom looks like the love child of Eminem and Eli Roth, and I think that that's on purpose. And I think that some of Tom's just crazy fucking, just his dialogue is shit, and I think that that's on purpose, because it's a nod to movies, because it's a nod to movies like I Spit on Your Grave, or a lot of the Eli Roth movies, I'm thinking of like the Hostel ones and stuff like that, where there's just that purposeful garbage dialogue. You're wondering why it's even in there, because these are otherwise very smart filmmakers. I thought
Hostel was like the primo example of torture porn.
Absolutely.
Well, I think, I think the difference between torture porn and extreme horror is torture porn is normally Americans paying for the sins of their fathers or the sins of things they've done in the past. That's what you get with torture porn.
Sure.
Extreme horror tends to be more political. It's all about, everything's kind of got this like politicized version of it. So basically, you know, like inside, basically it's, you know, she doesn't want her baby. She kind of wants an abortion, kind of. And then you have the thing about the woman who really wants her baby, wants to keep it. So you have the politicalness that's going on behind that, and the politics behind the cops. Also in Switchblade Romance, we have the politicalness of serial killers and what forms in that. Here we have the politics playing in the background of this, and the politics between neo-Nazism and far right and everything going on here. Martyrs has this kind of politics going through it as well. And some of the other films that were coming out for extreme horror, there's this political thread going through it, where torture porn is normally about Americans paying for deeds of either their father or paying for the deeds that they've done themselves.
Like Saw.
Yeah.
So, because even Hostel, I mean, they're paying for the sins of what they're doing and how they're acting and how they're treating women and how they're, you know, that's what it, you know, when you look at Hostel. So.
Yeah.
So that's normally the differences. But I would find that, you know, I do like the Saw films and Hostel films. When it comes to the French extreme horror, I find the American ones are kind of surface. And yes, you got gore and stuff like this, but the characters are quite surface. There's not a lot of depth to them.
Yeah.
Where even though Saw works really hard to try and find depth with it, you know, especially by the time they get to like Saw 7 or 8, they try to find as much depth as they can.
Did you guys watch the reboot, the Jigsaw one?
Yeah.
Yep.
I kind of like the we'll just kind of go off on this tangent for a second, but I really like the sort of the murder mystery dinner aspect of Saw. Like, if you ever notice I don't know, they're stupid, but they're kind of fucking fun in the way that they make it all into like a whodunit, even though it's just goofy as hell. But I don't know, I like the sort of time this
I have sit there say it's for a franchise. There's probably two great franchises out there that actually have your storylines match up. And Saw is one of there where they make sure that the storylines will match up. And they do a really good job with that. And Final Destination is another one that tends to join up their storylines.
They are. They're kind of well-told stories, and they don't get – I mean, it's fun to kind of pick on these movies, and a lot of people do, but they're actually like – The Saw ones are kind of fun the way that they tie it all together. I admit I haven't seen all of Final Destination, so I'm not quite up to it, but I know that they're good. I mean, they're fun to watch.
Yeah, they definitely all tie in together.
Well, Final Destination from the first one up to the last one, and then when you get to the last one, it wraps around back to the first one.
Right.
So basically, Final Destination is this great big loop that's going on.
I love it. That's really cool.
So, you know, which, you know, you don't find out. I mean, okay, you know, some of them are, you know, they're a bit weaker than others, but I'm sorry, like as a full franchise, they do very, very well. Unlike your Nightmares on Elm Street or Friday the 13th or anything like that, where, and that's not even get started on Halloween's storylines. Like,
there is no timeline in Halloween.
No storyline.
Friday the 13th tried to keep a timeline.
At least Jason's timeline went the same, but yeah, so that's, you know, so you have to give credit for Saw and Final Destinations for those. So they did, you know, when you do watch, you do like, you know, let's have a Saw week and you start watching one after another, and then it's like, then you see them start hooking up and tying things together. And like, oh my God, this is great. You know, but
those are so hard to watch sometimes. Like, but they, those are, the, I mean, the violence in Saw is just like, they're just gross violence, which I absolutely love. But sometimes I have a hard time, I turn away every once in a while. There's a couple scenes in this, like the guy getting boiled in the steam room or whatever in front here.
Yeah, like, but you know, the thing is, though, I have to sit there and say that some of these, this film does have that thing where it does suffer from what some American horror films does. And this film does, out of other extreme horror films, whether you're looking at you know, Martyrs or things like this, this one does suffer from characters who make really bad decisions and make really bad choices.
Yeah, there's no good choices being made in this movie at all.
And I said that's, you know, that's one thing that you don't normally find in extreme horror. Normally in extreme horror, it's like people are caught, but they're kind of making, their brains are kind of going and they're trying to find a way out of it, and their brains are always thinking, sort of thing.
Yeah.
And this one, we kind of get one where, you know, they do make a lot of stupid decisions. I mean, you know, you got the guy with his camera, he's, you know, basically the guy's getting stuck and you're thinking like, well, okay, the guy's stuck in this tunnel. So here you are behind it with your camera. It's like, how in the hell are you going to get through? This guy's skinnier than you are. And meanwhile, you're a bit chubbier, but yet you also got a camera. So this should be interesting, of course.
But still though, I mean, anyway, because when he was met with the big butcher guy when he got there, which I thought was kind of a nod to Texas Chainsaw Massacre too.
I think, I mean, Texas Chainsaw Massacre is considered one of the greatest horror films of all times. And it's not from an American point of view. It's if Europe, Texas Chainsaw Massacre was huge in Europe. I mean, because it does. And if you look at the construct of the original film, it does have that kind of extreme horror that the French would pick up on.
Right.
You know?
Go ahead,
Bob. I'm sorry. I was going to say, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre has its own display at the Smithsonian. Like, it's legit.
Oh, it does. I didn't know that.
It does, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's legit. Like, I don't think anybody argues that movie is high art. Like, it's somebody taking a small budget and doing something that no one has ever seen before, and it has an immediate effect on you when you watch it, and you can't shake it off right away. That's art.
I mean,
that's
and it's a very... But like European horror, I mean, it's a very slow burn film. European horror films, as you watch, as we carry on, they're very slow burn. They build and they build.
Yeah.
There's very little blood in it, too. There's very little blood in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
I thought it was kind of gory. There was a lot of body parts and shit.
All the violence is suggested violence, though. It's suggested. You're filling in the blanks.
Yeah.
You're not seeing it.
Which means it was a good movie when you're filling in the blanks.
Absolutely. Yeah, but like the whole scene where the guy's getting hung on the meat hook in the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre, you don't actually see any blood. You hear it running into the pan. And they did that on purpose because they couldn't actually afford to make it look real without just pushing the hooks through and cutting right away to something else.
Right.
So, and again, it's a work of art. It's basically a magical illusion.
The gas station that they used in Texas Chainsaw down in Travis County, it's like, I think it's outside of Houston. They've got it open and people are actually using it for venues here and there. It's funny. Next time I go down that way, I'm going to like have to do, you know, that Facebook profile picture, because once I found out it was open, it's like, oh man, road trip. I just got to go down there just for shits and giggles, you know, check it out. But it's still there.
Yeah. See if you can find a van, like a brown van, and just, Oh my God.
A VW. Get a VW van.
Yeah, the VW.
So, it was a VW van, wasn't it?
And just find a really annoying person that's kind of overweight in a wheelchair and put them in the back.
Oh my God, I know. That was the most frustrating part about Texas Chainsaw, because you know this guy is fucked. You know.
Well, to be honest, I mean, I love Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and I do appreciate the film, and I think it is a work of art. But I do hate Franklin. I wish he was killed at the very beginning, because he just annoys the hell out of me. So when he finally dies, I'm thinking, thank fucking Christ, he's finally gone. Why couldn't you have been first? Because he just whines. Like, oh, I'm going to be an enemy. What are you up, guys? I'm hungry. It's like all the way.
You know what's really fun? Like, oh, I always crack up when they get to the part of the truck driver when she's running down the street. Now, and he's doing his chainsaw thing. Oh, you know. And then that truck driver tries to help her. Why didn't they just start the fucking truck and take off? But you ever notice, though, the truck driver, instead of getting back in the truck and driving, he just starts booking down the street, you know?
Well, what about when she's pushing Franklin through the bushes? Like, where are you going, woman? It's like, just leave him there. I mean, gosh, like, push him through. It's
like, I know, someone's chasing me like that. It's like, fuck them.
I if Franklin was with me, I just do a fucking Heidi on him. It's like, take him down the hill, just push him down the hill. Old lady, down you go, Franklin.
Fuck self-preservation. That's the problem with this movie, though. The Frontiers, they're really, I think she's got a lot of self-preservation instincts, but man, she's just stupid.
Yeah. She does. I have to sit there and say that by the end of it, she does grow a pair, sort of thing. And she does.
Well, she's pissed by that time.
It takes her a long time to be pissed, though. I mean, the thing is like, you know, I mean, it's like, you know, they got this thing tied around your neck. You know that basically, you know, you bypassed your friend who's hanging it upside down. You've seen him. You know, you've seen that, so you know that's happening. You don't know where your other friend's gone, so I imagine that because you don't know anything about your other friend, you think the worst. I would think the worst.
At that point.
And then, you know, they got him tied off, and so he gets her out. And then, you know, she's making this big hoo-ha getting out of the cell, and you're thinking, for fuck's sakes, woman. And then when she does get out, you're like, where in the hell are you going, woman? I mean, come on. This is like, you know... You know, it's kind of like,
And she did try to save, what's her face? What was her name again? The one that was having all the babies, married to, not Gilbert. She tried to save her at the end. She wanted to stay with all of her mentally handicapped offspring or whatever it was.
I honestly think that some of that imagery that they were doing was they were trying to put some like deliberately mythic elements into this movie. I think Xavier Gans has read his Greek myth, and he was doing some kind of bit on Hades and Persephone right there. I'm telling you.
You think so? Looked like a vacation in Tartarus.
Yeah, because there's like, you think of like the gate image of her crawling through the actual pig shit. And then, like, and also she was several different colors very deliberately through the movie. She's black, and then she's painted red from head to toe, and she's in the white bridal gown right in the middle. These are all, like, very, like, hard, like, they're almost iconic images within the movie themselves. Like, you can, probably talking about this, you remember, oh, I remember when she was coated completely in red, and then she was coated completely in black, and like, the red is the blood and the black is the shit, and then the shit is the muck of the earth, and then we're seeing her get her head shaved, and the deliberate nudity, and then the deliberate wedding, and it's all also very inbred, which is again a lot of that's a lot of mythic stuff too. You're dealing with you know, incestual relationships and you know, all of the children of the underworld are deformed and everything. And she keeps going, she keeps being sent underground over and over again. There's, like I said, there's a lot of just strong mythic elements towards the second half, or towards the, I guess this is the third act of the movie here. And like I said, that's why this movie is interesting. There's layers to it. There's things going on. And I think a lot of it is deliberate. I think these guys are artists and they know their stuff. You know, that's what you're seeing with Euro horror a lot, is people who went to quality schools, I guess, for lack of a better word. And so they've got a base level knowledge of literature and myth. And so anyway, I think that those were choices, you know?
So do you think that dress that she wearing was a bridal gown?
I think it was supposed to be.
See, I think it was the best attempt at a bridal gown that you're going to find in a Nazi villa in the backwoods of France bordering on Belgium.
I took that as something else. I took that they dressed her up as a little girl to make her look virginal, even though she's a child. Because they kind of like,
yeah, I think had that little guys were super, well, let's not mince on this. I think that these guys are super into child brides. Like, we're talking about inbred Nazi hicks. They want their brides to look as childish as fucking possible because they're monsters.
You mean sort of masculine?
Well, I mean, Ava, the girl with the, you know, male deformed childness, the character's name Ava. I mean, she's very childlike. You know, the way she talks, the way she carries herself, and she's kind of like feebled. You know, and her whole ideology is basically waiting for her parents to come and pick her up. Her parents are coming one day, you know. I mean, I think she's probably supposed to be like in her 20s, isn't she? But she does have this like 10-year-old mentality, which kind of matches, you know, her husband's, you know, mentality as well, I guess. But it was quite interesting. I also found it very interesting as the family dynamics. And I love the way that what we would normally get in a film like this is that you normally get like, this is the bad family and that's it. But here we got family dynamics going on. You know, we got, you know, Getz basically wanting to be in control of the family. And then his brother gets, you know, is going to be head of the family when this, you know, when the dad dies. And you see like the jealous thing going on with
him. Son, and then, Oh, yeah.
And they, you know, they're the ones that kill the mentally challenged one. I forgot what his name is. Is it Hans?
Hans.
They kill him. It's one of the, who was it? Was it Getz that killed him, or was it?
I think he accidentally shot him, didn't he?
Well, I don't see how
it wasn't an accident.
It was an accident because he didn't.
Yeah, he was going to shoot their dad, and so it was Carl, I think, who shot Hans because he didn't want dad getting shot. Right?
Yeah, and Carl shoots Hans in turn.
But the thing
Hans
is, because
grabs a shotgun, shoots Von Gessler. In the confusion, Carl shoots Hans and kills him in turn.
Yeah.
That's when she escapes, and Carl and Getz go into the mine and chase her.
Because when Hans gets killed, I mean, it's deliberate. I mean, Hans is on the other side of the room from where all the action's taking place. He's the door.
She puts him on the rotary saw. Mm-hmm. It's like,
Well, that's Getz,
lots of thunderous applause.
There's a lot going on right there.
It wasn't a boring movie. I mean, it was, like you said, there was that little slow burn in the beginning. But, I mean, once you got going, it was like nonstop, you know?
Yeah.
And you're just, I was kind of rooting for her. I know that she probably fell on the wrong side of the tracks with these boys, but a lot of us girls do, but you know,
but there's a lot of symbolism going on it because
there
it's
is.
Funny. I mean, if you look at Carl gets his head shot off, Carl's the head of the family.
Yeah.
And when she shoots the head off the family, what happens? The family's going to die.
Yeah, and, well, you cut the head of the snake off, you know.
But I remember, like, when you're watching the dinner scene, I said, because Isaac was watching because he's never seen
Are they cannibals? They're cannibals, right?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Yes, they're cannibals. They're total cannibals. That's why they were chopping up all those
I mean,
people.
I just wanted to make sure everybody was aware of that. We have lots of, you know, human.
But I have said they're going to say they're kind of the weirdest cannibals of all times, because when you go into the freezer where all the bodies are, because apparently they've been doing this for a while now.
Right.
Yeah. And you think to yourself that they're wasting a lot of meat.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's just I don't think that they can eat. So like they already have the pig farm. The pig farm's doing pretty well. They're hunting and killing.
That's
people.
That's true. They do have a pig farm. Will.
Like you can only be on an Atkins diet so far, and then eventually you're going to wreck your kidneys. So they I don't know if they're getting their leafy greens in with all of those people and pigs that they keep eating. So, you know, you're going to have some bodies.
Pigs will eat anything, too. They could have been feeding human people to the pigs because, you know, movie? Yeah.
But aren't pigs part of mythology as well?
Rotting bodies were for the pigs to eat, and then the pigs would, either way, they probably all have, like, if Yasmin didn't come in and kill everyone, they probably would have died trichinosis within another couple of years.
What was that movie with the pigs? They kept throwing the bodies in the pig thing so they would eat
Hannibal.
The body.
Hannibal.
Hannibal. Okay. Yep. Okay. Yeah. That was driving me nuts because they just kept throwing the bodies in. The pigs would just eat them. you know. Mm-hmm.
But I mean, pigs are used in mythology anyway, so it kind of goes along with what Will's saying as well. You know, Homer's Odyssey is, isn't that pigs were Circe turned people to pigs?
Jesus chased the legion into the
swine. I was say, the Jesus pig thing.
Mm. Never mind. Yeah, I mean, I think that this, I mean, it does kind of make you wonder. I mean, I guess they were off the beaten track because they're on the border of France and Brussels, aren't they?
Right.
They're on their way to Brussels, aren't they?
I think that's where they were trying to get.
So
all I know is with my travels and my daughter next summer, if it says it's a free hotel, we're not staying there. Any free hotel is, if it's free, it's not for me.
Well, it wasn't a free hotel. They did charge.
Well, I think
They said there was going to be such and such amount per room. They go for one room. You know,
I don't think that they were going to charge. I just think they just saw lunch when they came in the door. And it was just really weird how the seduction part went. What the fuck was that? It's just like, what was I watching?
It was it was one of those things where, like, the sex is being used to make you feel uncomfortable again.
Like, well, I don't know if I was uncomfortable. I was just like, what the fuck are they doing?
Yeah, but isn't it also the simple fact, but doesn't that make, if you think about the women's role, if they seduce someone and then said that they had sexual relationships with them, and then the way that they set things up is that, okay, they'll have sex with the men sort of thing, and then the husband comes in, and for him to revoke his violence against the people, against the men that they're having sex with, is because their wives are being unfaithful to them. So it makes it easier for them.
They didn't seem upset about it, though.
To be honest, though, I mean, the thing is that you could, but it does give them ammunition to kill them because basically it's part of the game, isn't it?
Right.
You fucked with my wife. What do? When someone's messing with your wife, you shoot them or you kill them or you. I mean, it's basic. I mean, that's pretty much what every, you know, from the Bible all the way up until today, what all fiction's made out of. You know, that husband, wife, someone's unfaithful, and then the death of that spouse because of the unfaithfulness that happens.
Sort of like that feminist thing. It's just like they ruined it for us women that had a good thing and wanted to stay home. I want to be property, damn it. I don't want to work.
Well,
I'm kidding, Will.
I know, I'm just messing with you.
There's one aspect of the movie that I didn't quite work out because they show up. Okay, you got the first guys show up. Mm-hmm. We find out what's happened to them. They're off, and you know that one, the blonde haired guy, the Eminem and Eli Ross love child. he's got great pain thresholds because I mean he's carrying.
I'm gonna have to go back and look at pictures of that now.
Yeah, you think that he would have been, you know, after the car crash, that would have been it for him. But no, he's still going strong as a board, sort of thing.
That's true.
But then you get the other couple, you know, and then you get Yasmin showing up with, you know, her ex-boyfriend, and you're kind of going, and then they're going, well, no, they're not staying here, they're staying down the street, and then they go down the street, and you're thinking to yourself, like, really? And I'm saying, I'm sorry, but if I was the ex-boyfriend, and they go, the bathroom's over there, and I saw the bathroom, like, I'm not fucking staying here. I'm sorry. No.
The common sense logic that the viewer has watching this movie, just like, why do people run to the cemetery instead of the running car? You know, it's like, why don't you do the obvious? Why do you do this?
But I'm sorry, but if I'm gonna go stay somewhere and I'm gonna pay to stay there and the toilet looked like that,
I am not
staying there. I'm sorry.
I would have been gone. No shit. I would have been down the road.
Yeah.
ATW all the way.
Like, God. Yeah, I think that one of the things that's kind of the whole point, though, because all right, let's take a look at this whole movie is about bad decisions. I mean, from the very start, these guys are they robbed a bank and now they're fucking on the run. So they've lost a lot of the choices that a normal human being can make.
Do you think there was a reason why they made them Muslims as opposed to like just Parisians or regular French brats or something? I mean, why would he pick Muslim?
I think But I think I think the movement's for the neo-Nazis side of the story as well, to actually bring that a bit forward, I think. If they were just white people, then you're not going to
You think it would have been boring if it was just white people?
Well, no. I think if they were typical French people, then basically what you got, I don't know if the neo-Nazis would be as on board to eradicate, because we got to remember what neo-Nazis are against. They're against anything that's, I mean, the thing is, you don't want blonde hair, blue eyed people showing up, because because why would they want to kill them? Because, you know, they might be quite happy to reproduce with them.
Right.
But what we get here is, you know, basically to reproduce, they'll go, they're like, she's like a mixed blood. She's a mud blood or whatever.
Right.
Okay. We'll do, you know, we'll sacrifice it this time. She can come out with a healthy child, which she probably would have, because it wouldn't have any of their bloodline in it. But I think that it also kind of, and for this kind of movie, I think it kind of adds that extra layer to it than if they were just typical French. I mean, I guess you could really, you know, I guess, you know, if you had them Jewish, just sit there and say you had Jewish criminals showing up.
That would have been really quite an antagonistic situation if they were Jewish as opposed to Muslim, you know. That would have been an interesting take, probably, considering it was neo-Nazis.
Yeah, I do kind of wonder, like, after World War II, how would neo-Nazis, like, keep going in a small area like that? But I guess...
They're around. They're around.
Oh, I know they're around in Austria.
They're all over the fucking place. No, are you kidding? They use them. Okay, there's something called the Galen Org, okay? So this is spelled Gehlen. The Galen Organization was a group of Nazi officers who were pulled from the actual Nazi the fuck army to help guard Europe from the threat of growing communism. This is something that nobody fucking wants to talk about ever, but it's very fucking real. The Galen Org, they didn't round up all of the Nazis. They round up the really famous ones and kind of made a very public show of executing
them. Nuremberg,
they took the other Nazis and moved them in through the fucking rat lines, through the Galen Org, through Paperclip, through fucking
Paperclip,
the Iron
definitely
Guard.
Project
there
Paperclip.
A million different... Yeah, there are a million different avenues for Nazis. There was an open fucking job market bonanza for Nazi officers after World War fucking II. They weren't rounded up.
Exactly.
They weren't arrested. They were run back in. And hey, fucking spoiler alert, that's why we are where we are right the fuck now, because we allowed Nazis to shape things like, oh, I don't know, the School of Americas, where fucking Nazis actually started training the fucking overthrow armies that are running all over fucking South America right now. Okay? Mm-hmm. And half of the fucking reasons that the death fucking... That all of these brutal murders are happening in places like Central America is because we trained fucking... The South American armies through systems like Colonia Dignidad, which were run by Nazi the fuck officers. This is like real. This is real. This is an actual thing that could
happen. Oh, Project Paperclip and things like that. Those are totally real.
I know about that. What I'm saying, they're saying is, I found it a bit, I guess, because we don't really know how isolated they are. Sort of thing. We don't know where the nearest town is.
I guarantee you,
that's what I'm saying about this one family operating this way out here.
Yeah.
Like, you know, when you watch the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, we have this feeling that these people are, when we see the house and stuff like this, and it does help that you see everything during the daytime, so they're out in the middle of nowhere. And so you find, and you can say, okay, this can happen because they're isolated.
Well, the French countryside is desolate.
Yeah, but I'm saying I think because, you know, if you're an outside person looking in, you're never quite sure how isolated it is, because we don't have that lead up of how isolated, because everything's done in the dark time, isn't it? If they're driving at night, you know that they've taken him to the hospital at whatever time, you know, he died, and then they go in after them. So you don't know how far away they are from Paris. I'm saying that's why I know that neo-Nazis are out there. Don't get me wrong. I have a friend named Petra. She took me to Austria. She lives in Austria, in a place called Dornbirn, and she goes, so we go out into the Black Forest, she goes, oh, she goes, I'm going to take you to a town, but you can't say anything, and whatever you do, she goes, keep your mouth shut, and I said, okay, and we go out there, and basically, we go to a small town, and there's these SWAT stickers everywhere, you know, and basically, they're celebrating Hitler's birthday, and they do it every single year, she goes, they do this every year. It's like a small town, you know. Certainly, and it wasn't that far away from Dornbirn. It was probably like an hour and a half drive, sort of thing. So, you know, I know that neo-Nazis.
So why couldn't you speak?
Because, you know, if you say something stupid, you might not come home.
Sort of like Harrisburg, New York.
Well, let's put it this way. Americans are not appreciated everywhere.
No, I keep trying to tell people that. You have to travel a little bit to realize that. And that we are the baby Huey of the world.
You know, the thing is, they're proud of their culture, and, you know, I don't agree with it. I don't think that they should be doing it. But at the same time, I'm not paying tax in that town. I'm not living in that town. And so therefore, I'm not going to go to that town and sit there and voice, you know, my political beliefs to a town that doesn't care if I'm dead or alive. It's not my place. No. I saw it. I'm haunted by it. It's a good story to tell people now, but I'll never go back.
How long ago was that?
Oh, this was like 1992, 93.
And it wasn't that long ago. Just a town of.
Yeah, apparently a lot of small towns in Austria did this. It was not an isolated town. So you know, I mean, you know, and, you know, you got to remember that Hitler was Austrian.
He was, in part Jewish, actually.
Yeah. So.
Go figure.
But yeah, so what I was saying about the neo-Nazis, back to the film, is just that's the only thing I was like, I know that they exist. I just couldn't figure out how isolated they were to be able to carry on the murders and the way that they're carrying them on.
Well, even on a Paris train, you know, I mean, I remember just not even getting that far out, you know, on the way to Versailles where it started getting, there wasn't a lot going on.
Yeah, okay.
You know, it didn't take long. But I'm assuming you're 3 hours out somewhere.
Yeah, I'm just saying because we don't really get the sense of, you know, I think that if they got away and that's it, then they say they went from day to night and then they got in the middle of nowhere and it's like you're seeing like lots of countryside with nothing around whatsoever, then it would give us that more of a sense of isolation that you
could. Yeah, exactly. That's a good point.
Because you got to remember there's like a tunnel that goes from one house to the other as well, doesn't it?
Right.
As well. So you're kind of thinking, well, how far away are these two places? And, you know, and
isn't that a mine shaft or something? Or is it a tunnel?
Yeah,
well, they seem to be in a
actual mines, and that's kind of I kind of envision. I'm pretty sure that Carl may have been a cop or something like that because he's wearing that black uniform when he first walks in. I think that these guys were like tied right into the community, and the whole community kind of existed around this thing.
Yeah,
that they were a part of.
I guess we don't really know how big this community is or something like this. I think he is a cop, like you're saying, sort of thing. So
yeah, I don't think you run a farm of that size because you're poor. I think that those guys were like they had their own version of the Rotary Club out there, and they were probably running
the Rotary Club.
So that's
they were basically the power structure of that region, and that's why these people were so fucked in the first place.
Because I was like looking at, you know, plus I was looking at like the year this came out, 2007, and I was also trying to figure out basically is like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, for instance. If you're, you know, I'm just holding that as like a template, you're not comparing these two films because they're very different films. But Texas Chainsaw Massacre, we're under the impression that they've turned to cannibalism because this is what they've been doing for generations. Here, we're looking at neo-Nazis, okay? We look like that's 1946, that when the war ended. So let's sit there and say this family started moving.
They've been doing this for generations.
Not really, you're looking at two generations.
They at least produced one generation.
Well, the father would have been old enough to be in the war himself, and then he had sons, and then he had the mutant children, which will be the third generation. So we got this Nazi, and that's why I couldn't figure out the cannibalized version of it. So the thing is, why are they cannibalizing? Because it's like Nazis didn't really do cannibalism, really.
Well, I think that they were just. Yeah, I think that they were cannibals just because they were evil. And also, like, this, again, this movie is sort of a monster movie. Okay, so you have these cannibals, and they're all just, they're giant. Every single person in this movie looks like a freaking pro wrestler once you get to that to that house. I mean, even Gerda, or whatever the fuck her name is, I mean, she looks like she could punch a hole through something.
She's just mean looking, isn't she?
She's mean and sinewy, and like at the very end you realize that her and Claudia are they're the most dangerous ones of all. Like they come out almost like the super bosses at the end of this movie. So you have a family of just
basically vampires. I mean, this is what they are. They're blood-sucking fucking cannibals, and it gave some of them superpowers and turned the rest into mutants. And,
I was wondering how Yasmin stayed pregnant and did not miscarry through this whole film.
She wasn't very pregnant, though, was she? She's only, like, what, 3 months maybe at tops?
Yeah,
her stomach didn't really show. That's why I found it quite weird when Ava's, like, touching, oh, she's pregnant, you're thinking, what are you feeling?
Well, again,
I feel like a teaspoon.
Supernatural sort of vibe to what's going on here.
Okay, because I was thinking, like
what do you call it? What's his name? It's almost like a really gross, dark, horrible version of like Jose Luis Borges. You've got magical realism, sort of, but just in a fucking
Weekend at Tiffany's.
What's that?
Weekend at Tiffany's.
Yeah. Yeah, like the worst Weekend at Tiffany's ever. Yeah, that's kind of what this is.
Well, I remember like watching this and like she's you know, they got her strung up and Ava's touching her stomach and Isaac's like, she goes, oh, she's, you know, with child. Isaac goes, how the hell did she, because Isaac's big question to me is like, how did she feel a teaspoon fetus?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, yeah.
So, yeah, you don't even get a baby bump to like your end of your fourth month.
Fourth or fifth month, because she didn't really have a bump at all, did she? Sort of thing. I think she did. And the thing is, she just found out, didn't she? She wasn't. It's not like she was long pregnant.
And her brother, talk about his dying wish. He didn't want her to abort the baby, so you had that going on too.
Well, yeah. I mean, I guess this leads us a little bit towards the end, and it's quite funny. But if you look at the Wikipedia ending of it, so that she surrenders to the authorities.
Yeah.
Now, the thing is, I picked up what Will picked up, that the guy, the new head of the family, I keep forgetting his name, Sammy or Klaus? Carl.
Carl.
I keep thinking that Carl is like a police officer. So that's what I thought all the way through, that Carl's a police officer. And so then she gets away and she turns herself to the police. So she's turning herself over to friends of Carl.
Yep.
Or is she getting away?
Yep. I agree with you 100%. This is a bummer from start to finish, and those guys are, it's rough.
So she's just gone in a full circle, basically.
Maybe they were like real police, and they're going to take her back to Paris to charge her for the crimes that she committed as well. It's going to be a kind of a bleak ending for her, isn't it?
Oh my God, could you imagine her episode of Orange is the New Black?
I imagine she probably got all lesbian after this.
I won't blame her if she went lesbian after this. God, the men in this movie are awful.
You know what I did though? I found Ava very, very interesting in this film though. I liked the character of Ava. I found her interesting.
She was.
Yeah. Ava was almost kind of like a fairy tale character, you know, her being trapped there and waiting for her parents to return. Again, going right back to
that. She wants to take care of her children.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
I kind of wish we had a little bit more about the mutated children. We kind of get them as a threat. We kind of get like shadows of them running and stuff like this, but we're not quite sure exactly how bad they are.
Yeah. I see, that's kind of interesting to me. I keep going back to myth. There's something to that. Like, you know, the underworld children are just, they're not even really harmful. They're just kind of weird. And, well, you know, they started to eat Getz at the very end. And I feel like Carl should have just shooed them away.
That was an issue, Will.
What's that?
Yeah,
that was an issue.
But see, I looked at it more like they ate Getz because it was food that was available. It wasn't because they hated Getz. It wasn't because
they didn't kill
Getz.
Well, they're probably starving because, I mean, there's several of them.
Well, they're probably used to getting the slops. The same slops that you're giving your dog is probably what they're being fed, right. I imagine. Yep. So that's how I looked at that situation.
My dogs eat better than me, actually, so.
Yeah. I thought it was very funny.
Give them a bit of Getz. Might be eating water.
John Anderson of Variety said that it's 100-minute hemorrhage that doesn't bring anything to the operating table of torture porn, but more gore, cruelty, and misery, which for some may be enough, like us.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, so when it came to the children, because I don't think they were harmful, because nowhere do you see them being harmful, because even when they're in the tunnel and basically they're crawling through the tunnel and then one of the children pops their head up in the back, But there's no threat there. The guy thinks there's a threat because all he does is catch them with the green light.
Well, it looks kind of scary.
Well, yeah. It doesn't help that you have the green light on them either. Do you know what I mean?
No.
Everyone looks scary anytime you see a paranormal film and they got like the green, the night light on people. It's like, okay, sort of thing. But so again, so there's never really, they're not actually do anything to them anyway. You know what I mean? They're kind of there. You kind of see them shuffling around like cockroaches when the light comes on. They kind of shuffle away. So
right.
But there's not really a threat there, but they always kind of make it sound like they are a threat.
It kind of reminded me of that movie with the girls. There's spelunkers that go in the cave. What is that movie?
Yes. Descent.
Descent. That's what it kind of reminded me of,
Yeah, but they're dangerous and they are cannibals because, I mean, they're the ones that actually attack them, you know what I mean? So they're, but these ones didn't really attack. They kind of were there. So, and we know that Ava loved them and that Ava's sneaking them food. So we do have that understanding that, that's a mother's love. So love anybody, if it comes out of you, you should love it sort of thing. And
not awful. Not off. Always that. I don't know if I even, I could love someone like that.
I guess.
And I love my kids.
Yeah, but I'm sure that, to put it into more realistic terms, I'm sure that if you gave birth to a Down syndrome child or something.
Oh God.
Like that,
yeah. I totally love it.
Because the thing is, we don't know, they say that they're deformed, but we don't know. Maybe there's just...
all that inbreeding, they probably weren't too, healthy.
Well, it could be just mental retardation, or it could just be, they could have hair lips. We don't know. We sort of think, yeah. You don't really get it, Though they must be fucking strong to be able to survive that dampness of it all and be able to live in that cave with no clothes on. I mean, you got to be pretty strong to survive in those.
Yeah, that's a frustrating part of it too. But I thought that Karina Testa did an awesome job in this.
Yeah. Oh, I think everyone's brilliant in this film. I think it's a well-acted film.
I think it is too. I think it's well done completely as far as acting. I mean, it could have been, I know you were telling me it was going to be really, really gross and it was banned. And I get really excited when you guys tell me it's a banned movie that's going to be really, really gross, but it's like not gross enough.
Yeah, and like I said,
I need more gross.
Just for violence.
It's full of violence.
It's full of violence, but again, it's just an episode. Now they just run this every Sunday on your public television. Like, you can just go fucking watch.
Know about that. I don't know if they'd be putting this on regular PBS down here in Dallas, but I mean, I don't really watch cable that much anymore. I did think American Horror Story, now that's considered prime time. That was extremely bloody, this last one.
Extremely violent and gory this time around, yeah.
It was really, I mean, just think of American Horror Story. They had the corkscrew dude there,
Yep.
That it's like, that made me want to clench up my butt cheeks. So I'm just saying that, you're right about it, but I've never seen nothing like this on. But
I think we are getting to bits like this. I mean, if you watch Swamp Thing, for instance, I mean, you've seen people.
But that's
being
still not cable.
No, Swamp Thing's a TV. It's a cable TV. Yeah, it was on Hulu, and you see people being torn limb from limb on that.
I gotta start watching that. You keep telling me about it. I haven't. Is it just one season so far?
They're only doing one season. It's got this weird thing where Marvel had something to do with Warner, and then basically what happened is that just before the series was being thrown out there, there's some kind of fight that went on. I think probably Disney got involved and Disney took over. Disney bought Marvel, didn't they?
I'm still waiting for
Marvel. So basically what happened is and this is like 2 weeks before it came out. So then the show comes out and it's like a huge hit and everyone loves it, but they can't make it anymore because of the contract. So it's one of those things.
I'm still waiting. What was it? The Boys or whatever on Amazon? Is that what it's called? I can't wait for season two of that. I'm so psyched for season two.
That'll be out in May.
God, that's a great series.
So,
series, Will.
The Boys.
Yeah.
So I guess this brings us to our final thoughts. So Vicky, what are your final thoughts on Frontiers?
I liked it. It gave me anxiety attack. That's how I gauge my horror flicks by. If it gives me any anxiety, I was vested in the character, at least the final girl there, as soon as we're going to start coining the term. But we don't know really what happens to her in the end. Like you said, I would like to know what happened to her. If there's, hint, hint, but, No, I thought it was well done. It was pretty violent. I will give it an A for violence. It was very violent. So, and it kept me interested. I wasn't bored.
And what about yourself, Will? What are your final thoughts of Frontiers?
If you like horror, if you're drawn to just watching people get turned
mutilated.
Into, yeah, just beat the hell up. This is probably one of the smarter, more violent horror movies I've yeah. seen. And it's smart in a way that you keep thinking about if you watch it a couple of times. It's also an incredible bummer. So just know that, like, if you're looking for one of those movies that where there's like
no a happy ending
somewhere through, this is not that one. This is just, it is dark from start to finish. So if you're cool with that, though, it's really good. You know, and sometimes that's just the right thing. If you read Cormac McCarthy or are a fan of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, either one of those things might draw you to this. So check it out. That's my favorite.
And myself, when this first came out on DVD, I bought a copy of it and I watched it because I didn't know anything about it. And I felt a bit ill after watching it. And so basically, I didn't really want to ever watch this film again. And so
Will suggested it.
Well, no. But the thing is, I sold it off. I got rid of it.
Okay.
And I don't want to see this because it made me feel very uncomfortable. Rewatching it, I didn't feel uncomfortable anymore. So obviously, something's
I think you've been desensitized since it came out.
Well, I think a lot of times it also depends is like how you watch something. Like, you know, I probably watched it when it first came out, you know, not knowing much about it, but knowing that it's, you know, it's part of the extreme horror, and I probably watched it with the lights off, and I probably was home alone and sort of thing, where this time I kind of watched it through Amazon Prime, which is a totally different experience altogether. And but I have to sit there and say that I actually like this film a lot more than Switchblade Romance. The reason being is Switchblade Romance, the ending of it really pisses me off. But I'm
going to that case. Yeah, people don't like that twist. I like that movie enough that I'm okay with the twist at the very end.
There's just some things that don't make sense. Though when you look at it and then you go back and you rethink it. There's some things that are going on that makes the twist not happen.
No,
it's almost like I want to put a twist on it. So therefore, I'm going to just put this twist on it just to fuck with your brain, and it kind of pisses you off because it doesn't really work. Because there's certain
it doesn't work at all. That's actually I'm kind of obsessed with how poorly it works when you start to unravel the logic, and I wonder if I don't know. We could talk
about
that.
Switchblade Romance. Is that good, guys?
Yeah, I highly recommend it.
It's also known as High Tension. You may have already seen it.
I probably have. I just don't remember.
Yeah. But you're absolutely right, though. It totally doesn't work. I'm sorry. Now we're on another tangent.
We always do this. You have to forgive. It's you and Rod. It's always Rod and Will that does this to us.
You know. But then, I mean, but since that, you know, then I saw that, and that kind of the ending. That kind of. That made me feel the same way as Frontiers did, except that they didn't piss me off. And then after that, I saw Marchers, and Marchers really fucked me over a lot. And then Inside, of course, did the same thing. So, you know, so I think now revisiting Frontiers after I had experienced most of the extreme horror that's been out there, I think now I kind of look at it with more of a realistic eye, and it doesn't make me feel queasy anymore. And I have to sit there and say, I'm quite amazed with all the different facets that they're going on in this film, and I kind of got a lot more from it. I got the political aspect of it. I got the family aspect of it. Now that you mentioned the mythology part of it, now that kind of adds a different thing because all that makes sense now to me.
Yeah,
that actually gives me a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
Where I think before, I just kind of felt like I couldn't work out why the violence was there, sort of thing. But now revisiting, I understand why the violence is there and what it means, especially now living in 2019 and the political.
10 years does make a difference, doesn't a decade?
But I also think that we are, you know, now, you know, not I'm not going to bring politics in it too much, but now we're living in a time in America and in the UK and across most of the world, we're in this really volatile political landscape that's really messed up because people are a bunch of assholes and no one can talk. No one's talking. So we got this kind of weird thing going on at the moment. And we're getting a lot of this. We're getting, you know, in the UK alone, we have so many protests. It's kind of getting to the point where I don't even go to the
You West guys anymore. Really do, man. You're just like protest city over there.
Well, I just, you know, I would appreciate more doing and less talking. Like, if you really have a problem with it, do something about it. you know, in this country, for instance, I mean, Guy Fawkes is like one step away from becoming the country saint. So, you know, that's pretty much where we are at the moment, especially if we got an election coming up as well. In the next,
I put on your Sky Whatever news on my smart TV to see what's going on over there. Mm-hmm. And I just sat there going, wow, I thought we were fucked up over here stateside. You guys got so much bullshit going on over there, too.
But it's quite funny. So now watching this film through a 2019 lens, and you know, and then you look at the political nutness behind it, and that's why I kind of joke that basically
it's a it's true though. It's got a turbulent backdrop. The movie does. I mean, there's change and not an easy transition going on.
Well, that's why I made that joke that the film's basically about Trump getting elected and Antifa rioting in the streets.
That's pretty much it.
And you know, the criminals find themselves in a socialistic family, You know, so you know, and it's, that's why I kind of made that joke.
You may email all of your hating comments to info@llpodcast.com,
and I'm more than happy to receive them. But I have to say that watching the film now with a 2019 lens, it makes a lot more sense. And I guess because of everything that's been going on in the last 4 or 5 years since the first time I saw
film. About the social media aspect too, 2009 as to now, the evolution is phenomenal. You know, with the burst of everything, you know, everything everywhere. Everywhere's a camera now. There's nothing that's unseen.
You know what else I thought this film was very, very brave about doing? And no horror film does this. And because when I first started doing horror and working in horror and stuff like this, we're looking at like the 80s to 90s sort of thing. And then I kind of fell out of it because I was doing other stuff. And then I kind of fell back into it doing, you know, the editing and stuff like this. And it got to the point where it's like, to do a good horror film, you had to find a way that the cell phones did not work. And when you do a horror film nowadays, you got to find a way cell phones don't work because everyone's connected. This film, their cell phones work.
Which is quite
funny that they
the crap ones, the flip phones.
But the thing is that they got coverage. They got cell phone coverage because they call from inside the hotel.
Right.
You know, they call talk to their contact. So at any time they could have called for help, and none of them did, which is kind of interesting actually.
That's true. I didn't think of that till you.
So I quite like that. I didn't notice that before. And I noticed that. But yeah, going back to, you know, the film. Yeah, I like all the different facets and stuff like this, and I think that the film works a lot more, and I'm finding that the second time viewing it, I picked up a lot more from it now. And I think that if I watch it for a third or fourth time, I will take what Will said about the mythology because that actually makes a lot more sense. And now everything's becoming more formalized in my head. So than it did the first.
I'm going to watch it again just because I'm a mythology buff, and Will's got me interested in seeing that Persephone rising up every 6 months.
I'll throw one more, which is the most head smackingly obvious one, which would be that gets kicked off with the snipping of the Achilles tendon.
I did notice that. Everybody goes for the Achilles tendon though, because that is so that was the most brutal part of the movie. I thought it's not even the boiling the guy in the steamer, but was just cutting the Achilles tendon. That was just like
I have to say though that was a lot more effective done this way than it was done in like Hostel or other films where they just take like a little knife and go feet.
This one was really visual. It was a big visual.
Yeah.
So what were you gonna say about that, Will?
Oh no, just that that sort of kicks off the descent into madness where she literally turns into Persephone essentially, you know, getting dragged through the gates of hell, and then all the different colors and the shearing of the head and the gowns and everything.
I gotta watch it again just for that reason now. You're annoying. Now I've gotta watch it again. I'm just kidding, you know I love you.
Right back at you.
Well, this brings us to the end of the Literary License Podcast Frontiers episode. Just remember that next week we'll be covering Dark Shadows episodes 92 to 113,
something like that.
Anyway, people. Yeah, we're doing those, so that's will be fun. And then of course we'll be doing Dark Shadows at the end of that one. Of course, next month we'll be into our Christmas episodes, which we'll be doing Telltale, based on Edgar Allan Poe's Telltale Heart, two gothic operas, The Repo Opera and the Devil's Carnival, which you'll find quite interesting. Absolutely. Done from the producers and directors of Saw. And what are we doing for the European Horror? Do you remember what we're doing next month?
I don't know.
You guys,
I don't remember.
I shut it down. It's great though. Is it Dario Argento's opera? Is
that what we're doing? Oh yes, we're doing Dario Argento's opera. That's right.
Okay.
We're following along with Argento, our theater musical sign, Argento. So that's what we're doing, folks. Sorry about that. My brain just died. And of course, we'll be coming back with a Dark Shadows episode as well. And then we also have a special Christmas episode for our Dark Shadows fans that will be recorded in December. And we'll be posted off from Spain because I'll be off at Spain from the 23rd of December to the 6th of January. So I'll be taking all my work with me. So remember, you can always follow us on the Literary License Podcast website, which is www.llpodcast.com, or follow our social media, which is available on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr. And of course, we're on most podcast platforms, which also includes Speaker, YouTube, Podbean, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, TuneIn Radio, iTunes Radio, and Apple's iTunes in general.
We're
also available on Amazon Alexa. So if you go to Amazon Alexa and you have an Alexa, just go, Alexa, play the Literary License Podcast, and away you go. So that is good night for myself. So good night, Vicky.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, Will.
Good night, gang.
And we'll see you next week with our episode for Dark Shadows.
Naturally born, born bad. You came walking through the door. You took my soul and wanted more. I guess I was born, naturally born. I guess I was born.